Hello and welcome again to the channel. So in the last session we covered the transformations. We discussed kinematics, of course, in this chapter, but we were talking specifically about transformations. We covered the transformation matrix, linear and rotary transformations. We talked about global and local coordinates, and we talked about symbolic operations. But there was one part which we haven't covered yet, and that is graphical based transformations. So this short session, relatively short, will only cover about graphical transformations, and then we will move on to forward kinematics. So in this section, now in the past when we were talking about transformations, the procedure was more or less quite straightforward. Let me fix this. Let's do it here. Yeah, so when we talked about transformation in the past, the procedure was simple. You will be given, or we can actually go back and check out the earlier examples that we've covered in the last session. Usually you'll be given a set of actions, and then based on the actions, you will be required to find an example. Yeah, right here, this is a good one. So in this particular example, what we did was, we started with given a frame, right, which is frame A, and we were basically given So first things and foremost, you're basically giving the pen, what we call this, the frame, which is frame A, and then you will be given a set of actions. And then the first thing we did was first of all we had to determine the order, or the correct order of multiplication. And this is what we did by figuring out whether it was a global axis or local axis. Is that right? And I know this is funny or cheesy, but it's very, very effective. If you realize that this is actually a global, then it goes to the left side. So we start with action number A, which is the first one. And then we move on to this and check out this next action, which is rotate Z 30 degrees. So Z is a global action. So since it's a global, it goes to the left. So B comes here. And then what's next after that is, what we have here after that is X, which is again global. So it goes here. So that's C. And then after that is also global and global. They're both, basically it's all in this opposite of order. So since everything is global, the order of action essentially, or the order of multiplication, is in the opposite direction of the order of action itself. But then once we figure out the order of multiplication, then the next step will be to convert into a matrix form and then multiply. And then once we develop that T matrix, then we can proceed as usual. So for example, let me get back here. So basically after you figure out that translation, or after you figure out that translation here is after we figure out the order of multiplication to be, for example, E followed by D, then followed by C, then followed by B and A, we can then convert that we can actually then again multiply by simply converting into a matrix form. So for example, action E essentially is a translation. So action E is essentially right here, so that's action E. So we know what the translation matrix looks like. We then convert it into a matrix form. I did not actually include the solution here, so I'm gonna show the solution onto the third case. Yep. So I'm gonna use a blank slide for this one. So from here, so now I'm gonna start with the solution. So we figure out the order of action. Let's just say the order was, let me get back to here. Yeah, so let's say the order was C, D, A, and B, and E, for example, yeah? And then this one was a certain action, so we translate it into its own matrix form. If it was a translation, we use a translation template. If it was a rotator by X, then we use its own template, and so on. So we're going to end up with a set of matrices that are in the correct order of multiplication, the values of which are based on the template and then based on the values itself. For example, if this was rotate about x angle 30, we use rotate about x and then the value of the angle will be 30. And if this was translate xyz, we just plug in the values of xyz and then we put here the I matrix and so on. And once we develop all of these matrices, then it just becomes a matter of multiplication. And of course, we use the shortcuts and everything. So once we find out all of those and we multiply, we will end up with a singular matrix, and that will be the T matrix. Or the sometimes some books call it the homogeneous T matrix, because it's one singular homogeneous matrix that represents all of the actions. And once you find the T matrix, then it's just a matter of applying again, using it. Basically, if you want to find the new frame, then you take the T matrix, pre-multiply it by the original frame, and we'll be good to go. And that's what we did last time. It was essentially the same process. Determine the order of multiplication, determine the T matrix by multiplying, and then use the T matrix to find the new frame. Well, when we do this in graphical solution, it's exactly the same process again. It's just that the only difference between the graphical and the analytical, this procedure we can call it analytical, is that the only difference is that you're giving a matrix to begin with, and you're giving some actions, some definitions. But in a graphical approach, you will be giving the same information, but in a diagram rather than in a matrix form. So for example, let's just take a look at this situation right here. We have our own industrial robot, and we installed this robot into our room. Let's just say that this right here is a room and contains the whole thing. Okay, that's an ugly wall, so I'm going to remove it. So in this room right here, we basically describe a few things that we can define ourselves. For example, the home point, which is, or the home frame right here, it could be the corner of the room. It could be any particular point of interest. But and then we can put the robot in this particular point. R could be robot, it could be root, whatever you like, but I like the word root here. Maybe robot, but this is also robot, so I think I'm just going to use the term root. The point is that you would actually know this distance, because it's a physical distance. You can just measure it with a tape or something. So knowing the geometry in the room, you can find out the x and y coordinates of this point relative to the reference here, then we can find out this line here. Similarly, we can actually do the same thing for this other frame. Think of this like a table, and we put our object here at this corner of the table. So this height is available to us. The dimension here is available to us. And of course, the location of this box relative the box here relative to this to you is also available to us as well. And similarly, the edge represents the hand of the robot. And therefore, once again, we can find out this distance right here. And finally, this particular point here is the end frame. Now, right here, what this space represents right here, this could be the end effector. That's why it's called end. But the end effector itself is not installed yet. So we will simply allocate some space for the end effector to be installed later on. But for now, we're just going to assume that this particular length here essentially is dedicated for the end effector. And notice that the frame, the orientation of E is not necessarily the same as the orientation of H. There is a change between H and E. H is this particular frame right here. Let me draw a couple of lines on it. So H is right here, as you can see, and this particular frame right here. And E frame is this particular line here, and you can see that they are not the same orientation. Of course, they are not also the same position. But this distance is available to us as well, because we can just measure it. We can just use a measuring tape and find it. And this particular distance as well between the part and the end effector is also available to us. So we can find out the home frame, the difference between the robot end, or the robot root, and the reference frame. We can find out this particular height, and the location of the part frame, and the end frame, which is the robot end frame, and even this distance as well between E and H. So if you think about it, the only thing left for us to find out is the robot frame, which is essentially the robot that represents this whole geometry here. And when we use the word robot, we mean from R until H, not until E. Because although this is, we call robot, but in reality, this is a manipulator or the robot arm only. The end effector is not included, but we put a consideration for it, but it's not part of our calculations. We when we say robot in this particular context, we mean along from the R, from the root, all the way until H, through the body of the manipulator. Okay? So here's the situation. This particular frame is available to us. Now, this notation right here you see is essentially what it means is the transformation matrix or the transformation from the U frame, which is this frame right here, to the part frame, which is this frame right here. As you can see, it has a different position and orientation. Is that right? So the transformation from here, from this location, and this basically the first of all, you'll have to translate along this axis, then translate along, you know, this axis, and then translate along this axis until you get here, and then change the orientation with a couple of rotations. And then you finally end up in this particular orientation. So this whole action, or this whole set of actions that will result in transforming from frame U to frame P, essentially is described as TUP. Now the idea is, because we are already, or we already know frame U, and frame B is also available to us, meaning the geometry, the coordinates, and the position, and all of this is available to us, we can mathematically quickly find out the values for, or we can find out the value of the T matrix, which is this transformation matrix. Similarly, since we know this particular location right here and orientation, and we know this point in orientation, we can again geometrically find out or find this particular transformation from the part to the end. Okay, and once again, we can also find out these two transformations from the U frame to the root of the robot. So this particular transformation is available to us, which is from U until R, and over here is again the transformation from H until E. We always follow the direction of the arrow. Well, then, if you think about it, well, if you put it all together, let's basically, in order to then to use this information to our benefit, we will apply a principle that we used already in theory of machine. When we want to start at this point from U and then end up at this point right here. In other words, we would like to find two different ways of writing from U to E. Okay, two different routes. Okay, the first route is going through this way, which, let me change the color. So yeah, the first route essentially is here, going through here to the root and then travel through the robot. And then all the way until H, and then travel through here until we get to the same point. So that's one route. And that route is already described here. So you can see from U to R, from R to H, from the root until the hand of the robot, and then from the hand until E, that's one path or one journey. On the other side, we can also use a different route to get from H or from U to E. So again, we can just simply travel from here all the way along the green line, essentially, right? Until P, and then from here, P until E again. So that's actually described here as well. Now, if you think about it, in all of these frames, geometrically speaking, the only frame that we do not have is this guy. Because of the geometry of the room or the available spaces, we can find out these other frames easily with a little bit of measurement tapes and then some matrix operations and some actions the same way we did in our previous examples here. Then we can quickly find out those frames. And then from here on in, it's just a matter of solving this algebraically. See, this is the only unknown here. These two are available. We just put them to the other side, right? Right? Once we put them to the other side, then we can find an expression for T robot. And that's exactly what we're going to see here. So by pre-multiplying the inverse of U to R and post-multiplying the inverse of H to E, we can then, of course, if you multiply something on one side of the equation, you have to multiply it on the other side of the equation as well. So this is the same inverse that is multiplied here, and this is the same inverse that is multiplied here. Now, of course, since this is multiplied by its own inverse, it goes away, and this one multiplied by its own inverse, it goes away. We end up with this lovely equation that you see here. And in this lovely equation, everything is on this side is available to you geometrically. So then in this solution, essentially, we can find the values quickly. However, this solution, although very powerful and very useful, it has its own limitation. The first and fundamental limitation is that we have to assume that you will not change the environment. What does that mean? It means you will not going to move E. This is going to be fixed, for example. Or you're not going to change this table, or you're not going to move it around, because once you do, things will change. Or maybe the robot is going to stay always in this point relative to you. Because if you change these definitions, or if you change these locations, then you'll have to adjust those T matrices, and then you'll have to recalculate and redo the operations. You get me? That's one limitation. The other limitation, and this is probably quite difficult to see now. I need to clear up those extra lines. You see, when we develop this matrix, this robot matrix, although it's mathematically speaking describe the robot or can be used to describe the robot, it has a fundamental limitation. And this limitation comes from the parameters. You see, this robot, as we discussed before, is usually described by its own robot parameters, meaning this length, for example, right, L1, and then the amount of rotation here, which is theta, let's call it theta 2, and we can, let's assume that the base also rotates, so this is actually theta 1, and then we're also going to have this length, so this is L2, and this right here is going to be theta 3 and L3, and one more rotation here, so that will be theta or theta 4. And yeah, let us assume that there is one more rotation here, so that's theta 5. And this tiny but significant L4. So we want our robot to be described in terms of these variables. In other words, we would like to have a function that basically involves L1 or Li, which is all these lengths, and theta I. Is that right? Unfortunately, when you use this approach right here, the one that we just described, this is an ugly line, let's remove it. This, unfortunately, when you apply this technique that you see here, right, which is using the environment rather than using robot parameters, you are not gonna get a system that is described using robot parameters. You're going to get a set of equations and formulas, but none of them will involve a joint value or a robot length a link length, etc., etc. So that's the limitation. So this kind of solution is useful for instantaneous calculations, meaning numerical, or if you would like to find a situation at a certain instant, like for numbers only. I think the terminology is numbers. Numbers only means, if you remember from our last class, is when we have numbers only. I remember in our last class also, we did talk about symbolic or variables. Yeah, which is right here. And we said that the purpose of the symbolic operation is to develop formulas. Well, this is something that we will use in forward kinematics, of course, but obviously, this kind of solution that you see here, this one right here, will never be able or can never be used to develop a robot equation, unfortunately. Instead, this is only used for if you'd like to find a situation at a certain instant, where you can say numerical solution only. So that's another limitation for this kind of approach. Okay, let's move on to the next one. So, okay, here's a second example of graphical solution. And once again, we don't really care about the actual configuration of the robot. We don't know what kind of robot really this is. In fact, we don't even know what joint is this, right? We just know that there's going to be a joint here in number one, joint number two, three, four, five, and six, and then we have a hand. And then once again, we have an allocation for the end effector, and it's right here, and that's just about it. But what is also given to you in the equation, in this equation, that the following transformations, right, are all given, these guys. And when we say given, they're given like this. So this is one transformation, and from 5, which is joint number 5, to the camera, which is this camera right here, from 5 to hand, which is H right here, and this one from the camera to the object, which is this guy right here, and then we have from hand to E, which is this particular transformation. Is that clear? Now, what's going on here essentially is that what's going on to us is that we're giving the following transformations from 5 to hand. So whatever the transformation from joint 5 until the hand, yeah, from here until here, is already available to you. And then from 5 to the robot camera, which is this one, is available to you. And then from the camera to the object directly. I'm just drawing an arc here or a random line, but the matrix is defined as you saw just now. And then of course, from the hand to the end effector, as you can see here. Okay, so what do they want? Well, the question asking you to find the transformation from the end to the object. Basically, we would like to find out from here to the object. And basically, sometimes that's all we care about. We don't want actually information about the robot itself. We just want to find out from the end of the robot, let's say from the tool of the robot, what will be the transformation required to reach the object. This could be useful for applications such as welding. Like we want to know what's the approach from the home position until the surface of the welding surface. Or a pick and place robot. Okay, if this is the hold position or the home position, I need to travel here in order to pick the object and then put it somewhere else. So whatever it is, sometimes it's very useful for us to find out the transformation from E or from the end of the robot or the hand, the end effector until the object. So how are we going to go about it? Well, we are given some transformations, and so we need to actually then find a way to solve this using the given information. The idea is that we're going to apply something similar to what we did here. We're going to develop two paths from beginning till end and try to use those similarity paths to solve this problem. So let's begin by defining or assuming that we have this transformation. I don't know what's going on along the way between round or between the root until 5. Let's just assume that this whole transformation is available and we know it. Let's just define TR to 5, meaning basically from root until 5. Okay, that's one transformation. Okay, all right. Next, we have also the next transformation, which is what we're trying to do here. We're trying to get from root to object. In a sense, we were trying to achieve what we did here. You see, in this example, what we did was we found two different paths. What is that? Slide, yeah, two different paths to travel from the reference point until E. Is that right? And then and we did it in two sides or two different paths. Well, we can try and do something else in this particular example, but rather than going to E, we're going to go to object directly. We could have done it from E as well. That's actually doable and still can be solved. But then just for discussion's sake, let's just create two routes that go from R, this time around, to the object, okay? But two different routes that go from route to object. So let's take a look and see how we can do that. We started by from TR to 5. Next, we moved to from 5 to H, okay? And then from H to E, okay? And then from E to object. Don't bother with what we have, what we don't have. Let's just assume that this is one route. From the root to joint number 5, and then from 5 to the hand, from hand to end, and from end to the object. That's one journey, one route. Similarly speaking, we can try and do it, but now through the camera. You see here, we skipped the camera altogether. But as you recall in a question, we have some information about the camera itself, right? We have two frames given that are related to the camera. So in the earlier path, we used these two because these are related to joint, related to the hand, you can say, right? So now we can use the other two transformations given to us, but now related to the camera. So we start again from the root of the robot to the 5 again. And now from 5, we go to the camera because this particular transformation is available to us. And then from 5 to the object directly because that is also available to us. And then we skip H and E altogether. Okay. So now we have two different routes that go from the root to the object. Another alternative way that we could have actually started this question from here, from 5 alone, and we ignore tr to 5 altogether because we don't have it. And we would have two routes starting from here. Basically, in this particular example, we can just ignore this, and instead we can just say 5 to object. So from 5 to object, we can go 5 to camera and then camera to object. Is that right? And then in the earlier solution just now, once again, we can just say from 5 to object, and again, we ignore this guy, and now we have the same solution. Either way is fine, but to be systematic, rather than traveling from the middle of the robot, we always would want to travel from the base or from the reference point. Maybe that's what R stands for, reference, perhaps. So now, nevertheless, now we have two versions of R to object, or reference to object, or root to objects. R to 5, 5 to hand, hand to E, and E to object. On the other side, we have R to 5, 5 to camera, camera to object. And now we can start cleaning things up. You can clearly see that R to 5 is on the other side, on both sides, so we can then eliminate it. That gives us the smaller equation. And now, if you look closely, you will see that the only thing that is not available to us is essentially this, which is exactly what we are looking for, our target. Is that right? Everything else in this equation is already available to us. 5 to hand, hand to E, E to object, and camera, 5 to camera, and camera to object. So once again, just like we did in the previous example, we move things to the other side using inverses, and we clean things up, and that's what we see here. So now we have this particular example, and then we can then solve it. Since this guy is available, we can quickly find its inverse, and then put it here, calculate the equation. So calculate the matrices, and you'll be good to go. What does that mean? See, now we basically we come back to those original matrices, since they are all given. We plug them into this equation, the final equation that we have here. Yeah. We find the inverse of 5 to hand and hand to E. We put them in this correct order. We multiply the matrices, and then we find the matrix that describe the transformation from E to object. I didn't actually do this work. I strongly suggest, and I wanted to leave it to you as a workout, that you should complete this exercise. Complete this. Complete means what? Means actually perform the operations, perform the multiplications. First of all, find the inverse of, which ones? 5 hand and what's the other one? HE, yeah. Wait, yeah, 5 hand and then HE. So essentially, you have here 5 to hand. Yeah, you need to find this inverse first, and you need to find this inverse, right? And then you multiply them. So essentially, you have yeah, 5, and then here inverse 1. And then you have here T, what is it? H and E inverse 1. Then multiplied by, what's the other one? Cam and object. Is that right? So T, 5 to cam. And finally, cam to object. Is that right? You have all of these matrices in front of you. First, you have to find two inverses and then plug them into this correct order. And then actually multiply as usual. Now, this multiplication should be easy because you have a lot of zeros here. A lot of zeros is fantastic news. It means the multiplication should be relatively easy compared to those earlier examples when we had percentages, when you have those floating points, is that right? Like decimals. This one, we'll have to do multiplication a lot more complex. But this particular example is relatively easier to do because of all of the zeros and ones. This particular example should be easy to multiply. So I strongly suggest that you complete this exercise and find the actual answer. Okay? Okay, now we move on to this one more example before we end this session. This is another example of... this is another example basically a graphical example. What we need to do right now is to again essentially figure out the following transformation. So this kind of question is simple, that you're given a graph or a diagram like this with some information on it, but also you have more information in the problem statement itself. So I'm going to use the highlighter now to highlight important information. And then based on the information from the problem statement and the information provided by the graph, you will then be able to find out the following transformations. So let's begin. As shown in the figure, a pick and place robot is placed 1 meter away. This is the 1 meter away from the table that measures 1 meter in each side and ignore the scale. As you can see, this is the table right here. I'm going to paint it all in yellow. Okay, so this table right here, obviously, it should be a cube in shape, but it's not. So that's why the question said ignore the scale. You get what I mean? So this table right here, it's 1 meter on each side. So the width, the height, the depth are all 1 meters. Okay, so here we go. So looks like I'm doing an art class now. Yeah, and this also right here is also part of the box. So which means that the following is true. That means that the following distances are all true. That means this is 1 meter. Again, yeah, this whole distance, and this is also 1 meter right here, and this height is also 1 meter. Okay, so that's basically what is meant by one on each side. Okay, what else? Now frame, let's now describing individual frames. For that I'm going to change the color. So frame, let me use the highlighter. So highlighter, okay. So frame one, the O here means origin, yeah? O, frame one is fixed at the edge of the table as you see, as shown. Where is it? It's right here. So basically now we go and use this different color. So now this is now frame number one. First of all, that's the origin, O1. So this is now Z and this is X. And this right here is Y, okay? And a 20 cm cube is placed right there. Fortunately, I don't have another highlighter color, so I'm gonna do my best to paint it in this particular color you see here. Okay, so this cube right here, what about it? This cube is placed at the center of the table of the frame. Unfortunately, I know this question particularly. I think what they meant is at the center of the top of the table, not the center of the table itself. So I'm gonna amend this. This is an old version of the question. So the center of the right here top, let me use the pen, yeah, top of the table. Okay, so not the center of the word top is very ugly, so I'm gonna try it again. So eraser, actually the whole thing is ugly, so try and clean it. So right here we want to add not the center of the table but the center of the top of the table. So right here, let's hopefully that's it. So basically center of the top of the table with frame. Okay, so now basically that's where the small cube is placed, at the center. If it's at the center, then therefore we can then find out its location. Because it's right at the center, so, okay, well, we know now that this particular location of the box is right at the center, meaning that this distance right here essentially is half of 1 meter, so therefore that's 0.5, and that's also 0.5, okay? Similarly, also here, because it's at the center, right, so essentially this particular distance is also 0.5, and this also is 0.5, okay? That looks like a 3, but actually it's a 5, okay? Okay, what's next? So establish at the center of it. Now they were talking about the cube itself, the frame itself. So frame, where is that? Yeah, Now frame 2 is established at the center of it. It is being the cube, so at the center of the cube. Meaning that this particular frame, and now I'm going to use a different color. I think I'm going to use a different color. Let's just say red again, yeah. Oh, I can change the highlighted color. Oh, that's awesome. Okay, I didn't actually know that. So, thank you for the experience. Oh, no, I did not mean that. Okay, so now we go to this other frame, and now we painted it red. So frame number two, which is this particular frame right here, and it's by the way, frame number one and frame number two, as you can clearly see, they both have the same orientation as frame zero. And this is frame zero, the reference frame, basically. They all have the same orientation. How do you know that they have the same orientation? Just take a look at the Z, yeah? This is Z here, Z0, it's parallel to Z1, and Z2 is also parallel to to both of them, is that right? So that means that since they are parallel, so they are actually on the same orientation. Similarly, again, if you look at X, for example, again, X is parallel to X, and the same thing for X2 is also parallel to X1, parallel to X0, and very similarly to Y2, Y1, and also Y0, they are all parallel. So the only thing that is moving or that is changing about this frame is the location. Is that right? Okay, let's move on. So now let's continue with the question. The camera is situated directly above the center of the block, 2 meters above the tabletop. You can also see it visually in a diagram that the camera that is placed right here, is actually about 2 meters from the top of the table. So we would like to move this frame all the way up here, or we want to find the distance. But after we go up there, and then we then change, we put the position of the last frame, which is frame number three. So again, you have O3 is right here. And then you have now the frame. And now for the first time, you can see that the third frame is now having a different orientation compared to all the other previous frames. You can see now that this is now Y, no longer X, and this is now X, and this is now Z. There are different orientation compared to all the previous frames. Meaning, in order to transform from frame 2 to frame 3, not only we have to move the position, but we also have to move... We have to change the orientation. Okay? So, okay, now that we have figured all of this out, what do you want? Well, the question would like you to find the following transformation. But when we say find the transformation, means find the T matrix, a singular homogeneous matrix that describes this transformation. Transformation from what to what? From 0 to 1. You can clearly see, read it from here. From frame 0 to frame 1. Okay, where is frame 0? It's right here. And where is frame 1? It's right here. So you can now take a look at the diagram yourself and then try to answer this question. In order to move or in order to transform from frame 0 to frame 1, what actions do I have to do? And this is very similar to what we have done in our previous exercises. But the only difference that those actions or in those previous exercises, the actions were given to you. So for now, we're going to try to figure the actions ourselves. So T0 to 1, or the transformation from 0 to 1. What are the actions? If you think about it, the first thing I have to do in order to get from this frame, let me change my to highlighter. In order to get from this frame to this frame, I need to travel along this line first. That's the step number one. Then I have to travel along this line. And that's it. There is no other changes in orientation. So all we have is just a pure translation. Alternatively, I can travel this height first, which is 1 meter, and travel this distance, which is 1 meter, again, available to us. So it's either this along Y and then along Z, or along Z, then along Y. It's either way, it's up to you. So the very first clear action is the value along with the y-axis, magnitude equal to 1. Is that right? That's the first thing. Now, if you do this action alone, if you just travel from translate along y, distance 1, you're going to end up here. Is that right? That's the first step. And then now let's call this z prime. Yeah? And this is y prime, and this is x prime. Okay, prime means after one step. So in order for us to move from this particular frame all the way up here, we need to now travel along Z. But then the question now is which Z? Is it along this Z or this Z? You see, you have now two Z axes. One, which was the original Z axis. Actually, in reality, is this Z axis. Yeah, this one right here. the original or this the original z axis or the you know the standard or the fixed z axis, or the z axis that moved with us. Hopefully by now you will appreciate or understand the concept of moving frame or the concept of the local frame, because right now this particular z or z prime is now what we call the local z axis, which is right here. So to be accurate and systematic, I'm going to say that translate along which axis again? Local z axis, distance 1 again. Is that clear? And we are done. That's all you need to do. After you translate along z distance n, or the local z distance n, you'll end up here and the transformation is complete. Okay? So now let's focus on our or on this for a minute, on this Excel, this notepad right here. We have figured out the actions required to transform from 0 to 1. Now, that's just the action, but what we need to do next is to convert this into a matrix. If you think about it, we have done something like this in the past. In fact, that was exactly what we did here. You were given a set of actions, and then you have figured out the order of multiplication. First step was to figure out the order of multiplication. Then once you figure out the order of multiplication, convert into a matrix, and then multiply, and then use the matrix. Is that right? Well, okay, that's good. So now in this particular example, let's move faster. Oh, in this particular example, we have actually done with our first step, which is figure out the action. Next is order of multiplication. Order of multiplication. As you can see clearly, we're going to start with the very first action, which is trans. I know what you're thinking. Sir, these are all linear. It doesn't matter now. We can just combine the order of all the actions. I know you're right, but I just want you to be systematic. So let's just start with the first action, which is translate, which is this one right here. And then we apply our rule, G and L, basically. This one right here is what coordinates are we moving about? Is it our along? Is it the local or the global? You can clearly see that we have defined it to be the local. And once again, this is the local axis that we are moving about. So since this is the local axis, so follow the rule. It goes L, so it goes on this side, so it comes here. So trans Z, no more global or local here, 1 as well. I know, these are both translations. We could just combine them. It's okay, but once again, to be systematic. So since now we are done with this, so T0 to 1 essentially is trans 0, because there is no x value, and then 1, and then 1. 0 because we have no x value here, and then y is 1, which is the value here, and z is 1 here, and then that was it. And this is the answer for the first requirement, which is find the translation or the transformation matrix from frame 0 to frame 1. So let me recap that a little bit. First, looking at the diagram, and given with the information given to us, we identified that in order to transform from frame 0 to frame 1, we have to travel along this path. Translate along this line, then translate along this line, and then we already arrived. There is no rotations involved. And then by looking at the actions, we have translate along y, my value is equal to 1, which is right here. Then translate along the local z axis, which is or the moving frame, which is right here, and that will be this guy right here. And then we apply our principles of order of multiplication, and then that gives us the final matrix. Now the rest, which is the matrix operator. Then what you do after this is that you go back to the template of the pure translations, the one we learned already, and then you just plug in the values. Dx will be 0, dy will equal to 1, and dz will equal to 1, and the rest, of course, you fill it as before. Okay, so now we move on to the next question. I suggest that on yourself or by yourself, pause this video right now and then attempt to solve it yourself or attempt to solve the rest of this question on your own. At the very least, find T0 to from 0 to 2 and then 0 to 3 and then from 1, 0 to 3 is later, but try to find from 0 to 2 by yourself. So I'm going to give you a chance to pause this video now and then try to repeat the same process that we did here, but between 0 to 2. Okay, so now I'm going to solve this question again, but this time from 0 to 2. There are two ways of solving this question. I'm going to start with the long one just for I mean, you know, just to be systematic again. So we're going to start with t from 0 to 1. And once again, we're going to try and figure out the actions, order of multiplications, and then come up with the final matrix ourselves. So once again, we are here now at this frame, and we want to get to this guy. So we start with translate along y. Okay, maybe I should not have. Okay, yeah, it's okay. Let's just do it again. So trans y equal to 1. Then we have to go up. Is that right? So can I? Do I have to go here? Can I just go here directly and then go up this way? It's up to you. But you will see in a minute why going up to t1 again is useful. So trans z, now we know this is local, right? Local, or rather than local z, we're just going to call it a. So a is equal to 1 again. Okay, so now that you are already up here, I would like to now to transform from this point until here. So if you think about it, you will realize that actually in order to get from 1 to 2, we have to do the following actions. And let me change the color again, yeah? So, yeah. First, we have to travel along this line up to here. Is that right? And this is essentially around the local y, distance equal to 0.5. Is that right? So trans local y is O. So O, yeah, distance 0.5. Is that right? Yeah. Next, okay, now that we are here, we need to travel all the way from starting from this point, we need to travel all the way until here. Let me cancel that. Yeah, let me do that again. Pen. Okay. So we start from here and we travel all the way here. Okay. So in order to get to that point, we need to travel this distance right here, which is the 0.5 you see from here. So that would be along which axis? Well, this line is parallel, it's not parallel to y or z, it's parallel to x, but in the opposite direction of x. So there is no x frame here. Remember, after you did this step right here, after we did here, we have now a local frame. See, after you did this step, you have actually a temporary frame here. Okay, so that will be this temporary frame. So you'll have y and have x and we have z. So as you can see, this line is parallel along or parallel to the x-axis, but it's in the opposite direction. So then the value will be trans local x-axis, which is n, but since it's the opposite direction of the, there will be given a negative 0.5. Are we done? No, we have one more action, and that is actually, I wish I can zoom in here. Actually, I can. As you can clearly see, right, we did not really get to frame 3 yet. We still have to go up a little bit. And the reason for that is because the question says at the center of the cube. So the frame actually is not on the bottom. The frame 3 is not really on the surface of the cube, but is on the slightly above the surface of the cube. Is that right? And there's a tiny distance here because this particular frame right here is actually at the center of this tiny little cube here. Because it says clearly, established at the center of the cube, okay? All right, if it's the center of the cube, well, the height of the cube is 20 cm, so the center of it will be half of 20. Let me try and zoom it in a little bit. So if this was the cube, right, and we have the frame here at the center of it, right? So this is horrible drawing, but I hope you get the idea that basically at the center of it will be at the height is equal to 20 divided by 2, so that will be 10 cm. Is that right? 10 cm is simply equal to 0.1 meter. So we need, because earlier we were using meters, so we're going to convert 10 cm to 1 meter. So we need to translate along the z-axis, obviously. So trans along the local z-axis, that will be a again, then the distance of equal to 0.1. So here you go. These are the actions that required to travel from frame 0 all the way to frame 3. First, you have to travel along y, then z, then y again, but this time 0.5, then x negative 0.5, and then go up again through z, which is 0.1. Okay? Now, as you can see clearly, these are all local. So since they are all local, so the opposite of the action or the order of multiplication will be equal to the same order of actions. and then they will be all following each other. But since they are all translations, we don't have to waste our time. We can just combine into one singular matrix. So we can say that from 0 to 2, yes, from 0 to 2, essentially we have, let's just add up the math, right? So this is x, right? So x is simply, is only 0.5, yep, so 0.5 negative. That's the only x we have, right? N, there's no other x values. The rest are all z and y, okay? So a and y are both y's, so 1 plus 0.1, so that would be 1.1. Excuse me, that's a z. A is a z. So we have y and o. So that's a 1 plus 0.5. So that's 1.5. Yep. So that's a 0.5. And then for z, we have 1. And we have this again, which is the 0.1, which is this height plus this tiny height over there, right here. So that is actually is 1.1. What is it? Yeah. So that will be 1.1. So this is basically now that then from here on end, we just write it in a matrix form, get the template for translation, just plug in the values you see here. Is that clear? Okay, so the final one. Now, why did I say earlier that this is a shortcut? Well, there was a shorter way we could have solved this. The shorter way was basically to realize that in order for you to transform from 0 to 1, you could have just transformed, this is also equal to transform 0 to 1, right, multiplied by 1 to 2. Is that right? And the advantage of this is that this particular transformation we already have found from before. Is that right? So we didn't have to bother with the first two steps. We can just focus only our attention here. And so you can see that these two steps right here, these will be representing 0 to 1, which is transformed from along y and then along z. That's basically from 0 to 1. But then these three actions right here will be transforming from 1 to 2, right? So let's say the question also asks you to find from 1 to 2. Well, here you have it. We already have from 1 to 2, okay? Okay, so now let's talk about the final or the last difficult one, which is what about from 2 to 3? Let's continue our action from 2 to 3. I'm just going to copy this template here. So now let's just move on down, and now we have these actions. So now we have the transformation from 2 to 3. And if you think about it, this is the now I know that the drawing is not accurate. It looks like there is a shift in position, but actually in reality there isn't. What's going on is just the camera is exactly above the box. As you can see, directly above the center. Directly above the center of the block, 2 meters above the table. Unfortunately, whoever drew this diagram did a terrible job. They were supposed to make this Z3 line parallel, or not parallel, they'll be along the same line with Z2. Perhaps I will edit this diagram in the future and make it better. But for now, let's just ignore this misalignment and agree that there is no shift in X or Y directions, just go upward only this vertical distance. Okay? So in order for us to transform from this frame to this frame, first of all, we have to do the translation part, meaning we have to translate from this particular frame, which is slightly above the table, yeah, all the way to this point. Then we worry about the orientation change. First, let's move to that point, then we rotate. So obviously, we need a translation, okay? Along which axis? That is definitely along the z-axis, because at this particular point, that's a z-axis. So translate z. Okay, how much is the magnitude now? See, we can see that there is a number here called 2, but remember the 2 is from the top of the table. But this frame is not exactly at the top of the table. It's slightly elevated, a distance equal to 0.1, if you remember. Yeah? So then, therefore, the distance that we're going to travel now between these two frames is going to equal to 2 meters minus 0.1, so that means 1.9 meter. If you figure it out yourself, fantastic. So that's exactly the 0.1, the translation to this point. Now, after we go upright, what's going to happen? Let's take a look and let me do this first. After you do this action, which is translate along Z, distance 1.9, what's going to happen is that we're going to get this matrix right here. Or excuse me, we're going to get this frame. This will be Z. And this is going to be X. And this is going to be Y. Temporary, of course. Let me zoom in. Wait, I jumped. Let me zoom out. Yeah, okay. Right here. Okay. So after we do the first action, which is translate along Z, basically we traveled above. After we do this action, after we travel vertically up here, then, okay, the frame has reached the same point or the correct location, but we still have to make orientational change. So I want you to think about it for a minute. I'm going to give you, I want you to pause this for a minute and think about it yourself. How, what do we need to do, or how many rotations, or what are the rotations that we need to do in order to rotate this frame from this particular orientation to the red orientation? Or if you prefer, I can draw it for you like this. Let me zoom out a little bit. See, we have a frame. Let me clear up some white space here. So let me get rid of this. Yeah, just for clarity. Yeah, and this as well. So now let's see this part. I need a pen. So pen and yeah. So what's going on here is that we have this particular frame that looks like this. That's a Z, and that's X, and that's Y. Okay. And we would like to convert this frame into this. Let me change the color now. I would like to change this into this frame. Now, one, and this frame is now going downward, and this frame is like, and this particular axis here. And now this is now Y, and this is now Z, and this is now X. So now we would like to convert from this orientation, from the blue orientation, to the red orientation. Think about it for a minute, while then I'm going to come and explain how we can do that. Okay, so let's do it. So obviously, there are a number of ways we can actually go about doing this. If you still need time to think about this, you can pause this video and take your time. Okay, so let's do that. So basically, one particular way of doing this, you can see clearly that first step, we need to get this Z axis to go all the way down here, right? In order to become like this guy, right? So to do that, we have to rotate about the Y axis. Remember, we have to apply the right-hand rule when you rotate. Your thumb will have to be pointing along with the positive direction of the axis. So then your fingers will be pointing to the rotation. So in order for the Z to come all the way here, we'll have to rotate about the current Y axis, an angle of 180. Is that right? So that's an action right there. So now we have what we call rotate about the local y-axis NO, yeah, rotate about O, magnitude of 180. Okay, so that's the first action. After we do that, the frame is going to change. Is that right? Now, after you bring the z-axis here, of course, after you bring the z-axis, the other frames will move as well. So now, because the z will move, the x will also move, right? So they cannot just simply move the z-axis and expect that this axis is to stay. Obviously, this now will also change. So after you rotate about Y 180, the Z will go down, but also the X will go here, will become here now. So this is now X after we do this action. Let me clear up the area a little bit. So after we rotate about Z 180 degrees, now the frame has changed into this. Now the frame that we want has become, the frame that we are in right now has become the frame that you see in front of you now. Let me get back to the pen, yeah. To essentially this frame right here. But we're still not finished yet because we need to get to this particular orientation. So what we have right now, we have the Y here and we have the X there. If you now rotate about Z along this direction, yeah, this is also positive. This is also applying the right-hand rule. If you rotate about this angle, angle 90 degrees, the y-axis will move here. Is that right? Basically, this is 90 degrees, right? Oops, let's clear that mess up. Yeah, basically, if you rotate now about the local z-axis, you clearly see that the y-axis is going to move. So now we rotate about z, this z right here, angle 90. This y-axis is going to come up here. Is that right? And also x will move to it, also 90 degrees, and then it's going to come here as well. Is that right? So then that actually will be the end, or will be the transformations required to achieve our target. So then by doing this second action, this x-axis will also rotate, becomes here, and that will be the result that we were looking for. So hopefully you can see, if you did not capture this part, I suggest you can rewind it. How did we do the orientation? But essentially, we have now two, now we end up with x here, and this is y here, and that's exactly the orientation that we want to achieve. So first, rotate about local y, not about zero, rotate about O, sorry, letter O, or local y-axis. And then the next one will be rotate about z, or the local z-axis, that will be A, essentially 90 degrees. And that will result in orientation that you see, like, that will be the two steps required to convert from the blue frame here to the red frame. I mean, yeah. So in order to transform from this blue frame to this red frame, you will have to do these two rotations. First, rotate about the local y-axis, 180 degrees. Then rotate about the local z-axis, 90 degrees. This is the rotate about y-axis, 180 degrees. Oh, no, we missed it. It was earlier here, but then I erased it, and then we moved to this one. Okay, so this is particularly how you do orientations or orientational change. Okay, so this is essentially how do you do orientational examples. So first, you start by doing the rotate about, try to visualize it yourself, and then you can figure out the action. Now, if you are thinking right now, sir, I have achieved the transformation, but I did not follow those two actions that you yourself declared. I did it, but using a different route. I rotated about something else and another something else, and I was able to reach the same destination. That is actually 100% valid. You are right as well, and I am also right. Because just like all routes lead to Rome, actually, again, different orientational changes, as long as they end up with the same result, then it's also correct. Because they will eventually cancel each other out or result in the same matrix in the end. Okay, but then put this one note aside. Remember that although I described one path or one way of doing this, like rotate about, what do you call this thing? This is O and O, so this is rotate about Y and this is rotate about Z. Oh, no, let me keep this as local, right? So rotate about local Y and then rotate about local Z. You could have rotated about two other axes or maybe a different combinations, and you end up with the same result. Or just put a note somewhere that there are multiple solutions to the same target or the same problem. Okay, so this is now the graphical method. Yeah, this is it. So this is basically the part about transformations that we did last time. So with this, now we can say that we have essentially completed the part about transformation. This video combined with the previous video about transformations. We have talked about the transformation matrix in general, what it is. We have talked about, what's a transformation matrix and how does it work? A multiplied by A prime and so on and so forth. We also talked about the linear and rotary transformations. Linear basically means along XYZ, and rotary means rotation about XYZ, so on. We described the difference between rotation and translation. We said that translation can be easily combined, and the order of the order of actions is not relevant, but for rotations, it's definitely, it cannot be combined, and the order is very relevant. Excuse me. A bunch of exercises that I suggest strongly that you go through without reading the solutions first, and then you can get the hang of the matrix operations. And then we also talked about global and local coordinates and the differences between them and what's their impact. The difference between, this is a local rotation, but this is a global rotation, so you can see the difference between them. And we also talked about graphical base, which is today we covered it, and we saw that graphical base can be useful in the sense that we can use geometry and information available to us in the environment to find and solve matrix robot operation and transformations operation. But the environment questions will not be useful for us when we try to develop robot equations, unfortunately, because these environmental matrices use variables from the environment. They do not use variables from the robot. So you can see, if you come back here to this slide, this particular slide right here, we can say that those guys right here, they are not actually function of those. They are function of the environment. So they are not useful for us in that particular order, but they are useful for us when it comes to numerical operations. Second example we went through, I suggest you go through the video again. And then we talked about this particular example, and we took our time with it. I only solved until from 0 to 3, but you have two other examples. I suggest you can then find and do it yourself. And we also talked about this last week, or last session. We talked about the important, or basically about symbolic operation or variables, that this is the real importance or the real reason why we do kinematics or transformations and frame matrices. Because we want to develop the matrix for each robot and then use it later on. So for example, in this particular example, or these actions, after we develop the T matrix, we develop essentially this matrix right here. And this matrix right here essentially is the reason why we do this all together. Because you remember that this particular matrix, although it's a transformation matrix, it's also a frame matrix. So every item, let's say this item is equal to px, and this item is also is equal to py, and this is pz. So given the parameters from this side, we can then find the corresponding values. An example, if you would like to find the corresponding x, y, z coordinates of this particular robot, you just need to know the x value, the y value, and z value, and then the angle. I know that x, y, z are also here, so this seems redundant. But this is an example. Once we talk about, next session, when we talk about robot kinematics, this will make better sense to you, or the difference between robot parameters and robot, the end effector of the robot. All right. So I think with this, we are done with this session, and I will end the session now. Thank you very much for watching. In the next session, we will talk about about robot forward kinematics. So I'll see you in the next session. Take care.